There's only one way to come to the place that you have no fear whatsoever. And that's to be established in the Word of God. Amen. That's to meditate on His Word, like Joshua 1:8. Meditate on His Word day and night and day and night. To observe and to do all that is written therein. Then you'll make your way prosperous. Then you'll have good success. One time I was up late at night and I was worried about finances. And I was in business and I learned a lot, of course, being in business, but what I had done is I had taken on a job that was way bigger than the capital I had to operate under. Because of the fact that you have to work for 30 days, submit a bill, and then wait for 30 days to get paid on that first bill, you got 60 days labor and material into the project before you get a dollar. So I was about 40, 45 days into this project, and I had used up all my capital because I hired a whole bunch of guys. I had to. And I was going, God, what in the world? How am I gonna make this? How am I gonna get this? So I'm up late at night. TBN was on. I forget who was on talking. But the Lord spoke to me and said, I want you to give this guy $1,000. I said, have you ever noticed the Lord doesn't say, is this a good time? He said, I want you to give this guy $1,000. So I get up, go to my office, and my office was in my house at the time. And I went in my office and I looked. I had like $1,006 in my checking account. So I said, okay. So the next day I go to get that check, and there had been a check written that wasn't registered, and I didn't have $1,000. When I found that out, I said, Lord, I don't have the money. He said nothing. So it took me 2 weeks before I had that $1,000. But that was my first goal, is to get that paid. And I was under such pressure. And so I finally got the money, and I wrote the check, and I sent it off. Listen, this is what righteousness will do for you. I sent it off. And when I sent that money in, all of a sudden, the pressure wasn't on me anymore. It was on Him. Had I not been obedient to do what He told me to do, I could have never believed Him to meet that need. But because I was obedient, when the pressure started coming on me, I said, Lord, hey, you've heard this. You got mail. I know that sounds bad, but it's true. I told the Lord when I first started in, I said, God, if you meet my need, I'm going to tell everybody. And if you don't meet my need, I'm going to tell everybody. Been 30 years now. But my obedience and my writing that check brought me to the place that I could trust the Lord. See, we have to have that relationship with Him. It's all about us knowing Him. It's all about us obeying Him, walking every day with Him, trusting in Him, giving Him our past, our present, our future, totally relying on Him. Yeah. I have to trust Him with my family, my kids, my grandkids. I have to trust Him with my marriage. Come on, isn't it true? Yeah. I have to live for God regardless of how my family thinks, how my wife thinks. And I'm not saying she's not in agreement with me. I'm just saying He's first. She feels exactly the same way. She should. Amen. We got to come to the place that we have this walking relationship with the Lord and we simply do what He says. And when you come to the place that you do that, you'll be able to have faith to do great things. But if you don't have faith enough to obey, you're not going to have faith enough to stand. And I know when I wrote that check, I was amazed at the strength that come up on the inside. And I said, hey, now it's on the Lord. And I don't think He's going to sit up all night chewing His fingernails saying, what am I going to do? Right? And do you know He supernaturally met that need? You know one of the ways He did it? The craziest thing. I went, in the next week or so, I went to a Kenneth Copeland convention. And I'm in this group of, I don't know, 5,000 people. I'm in the nosebleed section, way up high. And I am, listen, I am just enjoying. They had an awesome worship. And all day long, about five messages, and I'm soaking up the word, and I'm just enjoying this so much. And so it was another worship service that day. There was five worship services and five messages every day for 5 days. And so I'm three or four days in, and I'm soaking up the worship, and man, I'm just lost in worship. This is crazy, but I'm telling you, this happened. The devil walked up to me, got about this close to my face, and said, "I got you now." I was shocked. Jerked me right out of my praise. I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "You didn't hand in that bill." And see, my bills had to be right on time because I didn't have enough capital to relax and just whenever it comes, it comes. It was so tight. It was a miracle, as a matter of fact, it was. I can tell you other stories, but this one, I got enough with this one. So he said, "You didn't hand in that bill." I thought, oh my gosh, he's right. I got caught up in all this worship and went to Chicago and I forgot that bill. This was on a Friday night. That bill had to be in at the end of the week because I had to be paid next week on it. I said, oh my gosh, he's right. So I had my scripture keys and I had my confessions, and one of my confessions is, I trust in the Lord with all my heart and I refuse to worry about anything. I trust in the Lord with all my heart and I refuse to worry about anything. And I must have said that 1,000 times. I was trying to talk me into it. Hey, listen, don't knock it. Get in there and say it. And so I'm praying. I said, "Lord, what do I do?" And he gave me an idea. My brother-in-law worked for me. And the guy who owned the company, we had worked on his house. So I called him. I said, "Do me a favor." This was Saturday now. I said, "I need you to go break into my house." I said, "That bill that I was supposed to hand in is on my desk." I said, "Get that bill, drive it right to Brinker's office." Don, was he Brinker? I don't know which one he was. It's been a long time ago now. But I said, "Drive it right to his house," because we worked on his house. "Knock on his door and hand it to him personally." He said, "Okay." So he went and got in my house, drove to Detroit. Thank God we had been to this guy's house. Knocked on his door. He came to the door. And Ron said, "Hey," he said, "Dave wanted me to hand this to you personally because it's important that he gets this bill into you." He said, "Okay, thanks." Took it. I got paid. So I said, "Lord, you can even use the devil." But listen, you don't have to fear if God's coming through for you or not. The children of Israel, he brought them out of Egypt. He parted the Red Sea. He brought them into a land where there's no rain, a quarter of an inch of rain every 10 years. He had a pillar by a fire to keep them warm at night, a cloud by day. He fed them manna every day. They drank of that rock, Christ Jesus. They walked across that desert. They come to the promised land, and they wouldn't go in. He already had a plan. Do you know that that generation died off? And then God had Joshua take the next generation in. Do you know when they got in there? Do you know what them people told them? "Where you guys been? We were ready to lay down our arms and walk off this property 40 years ago, but you guys never came." Listen, here's my point. The Lord had a plan. He had already planned for their success. But they didn't have faith enough to step in there. God has already planned for your success. But you're going to have faith enough to step in there. And if you're playing around with sin, you ain't going to do it. It's the truth. Having this intimate, everyday walk with the Lord, trusting in Him. When you wake up in the morning, He's first on your mind. When you go to bed at night, He's the last thing you think they're thinking about. It's just in Him you live and you move and you have your being. It's all about Him and your relationship with Him, your walk with Him, your testimony for Him. It's all about Him. And if you'll do that, and if I'll do that, I will be a good testimony for Christ. And I love those testimonies. Like one time, Brother Kenneth Copeland, he said the devil came to him, said, "You're not going to have your knee bent on this campaign you're doing." It was a lot of money for some particular campaign he was involved with, ministry. And he said the devil got so strong and got right in his face and said, "Your knee isn't going to be bent on this one." He said, "Really?" He said, "Okay, I'll tell you what, I'm not going to take up any offerings." He said, "Do you know the Lord supernaturally took care of me?" He said, "I refused to take up an offering through that whole meeting. Teach the devil to mess with me." I mean, this is the way we're supposed to be living our life. We're supposed to be standing up and walking by faith. Amen? We just need to, what are you exercising your faith on? What faith goal have you got out in front of you right now? Believe in God. I may know some of them. Listen. When we started this... Oh, man, I'm out of time. Shoot, I just started feeling like I'm getting going now. Lord. When we built this church, we didn't have any money. We were in the foyer, didn't have any money. $10,000 came in. A guy stood up and he said, "I got $500. I want somebody to match it." I never said a word. Before they got done, there was 10 grand. They said, "What are we going to do?" I said, "Well, let's get a blueprint drawn." Things took off. To make a long story short, the money came in to dig the footings. We spent it. After we got the footings done, the money came in to build the walls. We built the walls. When we got the walls built, the money came in to put the subfloor down. We put the subfloor down, the money came in to put the walls up. I ordered the trusses, $20,000, 52-foot scissor trusses. I called, they called me and said, "Hey, your trusses are in on a Friday." I didn't have any money. I said, "Thank you," hung up. I'm sure they wondered, why didn't he say he's going to come get them? Sunday morning I got up, didn't say a word. Why? Our pressure's not on each other, our pressure's on the Lord. We live with God, we walk with God, we trust the Lord. Secretary calls me Sunday night and said, "Pastor Dave, you're not going to believe this. We got our normal offering in this morning, and somebody put in a check for $20,000. I said, "I'll be right over tomorrow morning. I got to get that money." So when we got the money, went and bought the trusses. We've got the trusses up. I mean, just come to find for drywall contractor. Went to one company in town, said, "I'm doing my church. What do you do?" The guy said, "We'll give you all the board." He went to another company, supply company in Lansing, said, "Hey, Great Lakes is giving me the board. What do you guys do?" He said, "Well, we give you all the tape and the bead." We got the drywall done. A painting contractor joined the church. "So you mind if I paint it for you?" So we need to be living this way. Hallelujah. We're getting ready for a school. I think to get this church ready to go and to start the school off, we're going to be at about $195,000. And we're in no way going to bring in that tuition. By the way, 2 days of school have happened now. And it's wonderful. We've got 23 kids. I'm really excited. And it's just going to grow from here. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. But I went and got the price for the fire alarm system and the security system. Just the fire alarm system was $23,000. And that's with us pulling all the wire. Now, see, one thing that does bug me is I'm not up on this stuff to know if it's fair. I mean, I want to. God delights in a just measure, but prices are so insane right now. I struggle with what's just, right? Anyways, I get the prices. That week, I have handed to me $21,000 from a couple of different sources. I said, "God, you're so good. You're so good." And we're gonna expand the church. We're gonna put an addition. It's gonna broaden our sanctuary. We'll add about 120 people to our sanctuary, but it will make more room for the school here too. And as soon as we get that done, then we're gonna build our school out there. And it's gonna be at least $1 million to build a school. And I don't I don't have the money. Do you have the money? One preacher got up in front of the congregation. He said, good news, good news, good news. He said, the money for our addition is here. We've got it. Everybody cheers. He said, the only problem is it's in your pocket. Here's my point. We have to have this everyday faith walk with God. You need to have a faith goal. If you don't have something in front of you today to apply your faith to, you need to get it written down and start exercising your faith. And don't think small.